It's great to be here at the very first Integral European Conference. A real success to bring it together for the first time. I'm sure it'll be the first of many. A very important step in being able to cohere the Integral community in Europe, to build the field that is really going to help others to engage with this in the future as well.
I'd love to be here. It's so right for me and for all of us that we are here. And I really hope that this is a starting point from the rest of the Integral consciousness in the world.
I'm here because I'm interested to see if the Integral scene is ready to go out of the mind into the streets.
When I heard there was a conference here, we immediately said, yes, 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 it's a gorgeous city. And in some way so advanced, because it's a European city, an old city, a city that has a long history, as you all know, that makes a difference in its consciousness, I think.
Hello. We proudly present IEC 2014 in Budapest.
This conference was organized together with Integral Europe team, with the Integral Academy team, and the Integralist Forum. And we have other partners, but really, people from these communities are pushing forward this conference and made it happen. Integral European Conference has three meanings. The first layer is get integral Europeans together to create a truly integral encounter here. The integral theory is an evolutionary theory, as you know. It speaks about levels of consciousness. The most exciting area in the levels of consciousness between birth and full enlightenment is level 6. And I think this is the maturity of the integral world. We have to create an integral where the turquoise and higher is integrated, as the spiral dynamic shows, or as the level shows, with all the other levels. So this is the standpoint from what Integral European Conference is made, and the integral format of a conference where we weave together the mental, the transformational, the communal, to exercise our whole human being.
It's a matter of trust, so it's really, we had to have faith in the integral vision, and that's why we're here, because we have faith in it. And so these days our mantra is, relax, nothing is under control, you know, especially organizing such a conference. Now we're here we received 165 or more applications, proposals, when giving out this call for paper. There's tremendous richness out in the field. So many of you we wanted to feature, and so we evaluated each and every one of these, you know, according to a lot of dimensions, criteria. And so we came up with this structure, which is hopefully, you know, it's an experiment. We'll go into this later. But, you know, we have politics, education, psychology, business, spirituality, et cetera, a lot of applications. And we hopefully can bring to surface the great wealth of Integral in Europe. My intention is here to really share that gift of clarity and love that I received from Kant's work and also from the Integral theories that I've studied, and make it, you know, let's bring it out, let it ripple forth throughout all directions and share it with the world.
A warm welcome to the Integral Europe team. And I invite the Integral Academy team. And I would like to welcome on stage the Integralist Forum from Germany, the members who are here.
I'm here to talk about the relationship we have in our ideas with Integral Foundations, Integral Institute, and the Club of Budapest. We believe in a whole global holistic world, in a global holistic consciousness.
This world that we have created is not sustainable.
as it is. Not that humanity is not sustainable. The world we have created is not. Because this world is fragmented. It's kind of a jungle. A dog is dog very often. I think the world is integral. And if we start thinking integrally, we are beginning to grasp what the world is like. There is such a thing as having an integral consciousness. And that's a consciousness that's more able to perceive what there is, more able to relate to what there is. Integral means in very many different ways, means whole, means not separated, means not divided, means being one. And the key concept that always comes up is consciousness. What you do is very much a reflection of your consciousness. Now, if this is an integral world, you need an integral consciousness. What is an integral consciousness? Let me just say first what it is not. The current concept, the dominant so-called mainstream concept of consciousness, is what I call the turbine theory. Now, I think this is a very dangerous concept because it separates it off. It's my consciousness, my brain generates it, that's the way it generates it. Everybody's consciousness is separate. This kind of consciousness has come up against the problem that if the brain generates consciousness, consciousness should stop when the brain stops. It turned out many clinical trials showing that when people are on the threshold of death, but they come back, and this near-death experience, for example, they have conscious experience where the brain is flat. And there is very much contact. There's something more to it, and there is much evidence also. What you do would affect the rest of the cosmos. If you evolve your consciousness, that will evolve the consciousness of the cosmos. A small input, but in a hologram, every change in every part is reflected in every other part. It might sound like science fiction, but it is now coming from quantum physics, and you join it together with evidence, your consciousness can be informed by this holographic consciousness in the cosmos. Therefore, you can have an integral consciousness. And with this integral consciousness, you can be part of the world. You can contribute to the world.
This is Ken Wilber, and I'd like to talk briefly about how I see the integral movement in Europe and the Integral European Conference in particular. America is a very young nation where some European countries go back thousands of years. America is barely over 300 years old. In many ways, particularly cultural, we're still adolescent. Tests consistently show an ignorance of other countries that is just embarrassing. America. But Europe. Europe is a different story. It's been around almost from the beginning of humankind's history on this planet. And Europe has that atmosphere, that background, that is still with it today, drenching it with depth. The deep yearning for unity would periodically break out in specific manifest forms in various ways in Europe throughout the ages. This depth of oneness, hidden under the surface of the face of manyness, hangs in the air you breathe in Europe. It runs in the veins of virtually every European. It speaks the depths of the yearning of the human heart, the heights of the human mind, the inclusiveness of the human community. This depth is everywhere you go in Europe. It is the neatest, cleanest, damn continent on the face of the planet. Europe has the slight edge in structural developmental evolution heading toward integral. The other advantage Europe has is that many of its countries, and certainly the continent on the whole, has had entire civilizations that were at magic and at mythic and at rational and now at pluralistic. And thus, although everybody everywhere is born at square one and starts their own growth and development through the stages from there, Europe has cultural memories of entire civilizations at all the earlier stages lying in its background, a surefire, sturdy foundation upon which integral can emerge. Perhaps the one thing that America can truly be proud of, virtually every other country or nation on the planet was founded along racial and ethnic lines, with particularly similar tribes banding together to eventually form what would be a nation. But from the start, America was born based on a universal philosophical principle, not an ethnic or racial or tribal lineage. As Abraham Lincoln pointed out, America was, quote, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Dedicated to the proposition, the first time anywhere in history, an extremely varied group of tribes from all over the world came together, united by an idea, not just a race, based on ideas and principles created mainly in Europe. America began the great experiment of the creation of something resembling the beginning of a world culture. In many ways, it succeeded wonderfully. In others, the sheer span of its reach seemed to limit its depth, leaving it with a love of surfaces, an Andy Warhol version of a country, all surface, no depth, and thus that's so American. But we are now seeing, in America and Europe especially, the emergence of a strong pluralistic stage, and hence already approximately 4% in America and 5% in Europe, the emergence of the next higher integral stage into conventional everyday awareness.
Welcome in the video form, Roger Walsh.
Thank you very much, Ben Scanty, and all the people who worked so hard to make this conference possible for us all. And thank you for the opportunity of being with you. I'm sorry I can't be there in person. How we can apply the integral vision to help and heal our troubled world. We have to be really competent in the areas in which we're trying to work. The first step of becoming an effective Gnostic intermediary is to imbibe the wisdom. The second is to master the concepts and language of the community we're trying to cultivate. We need to be able to translate contemplative wisdom into the concepts and language of the community that we're trying to communicate to, so as to create an aha experience. So these perennial, profound ideas make sense in the language and concepts of the people we're communicating to. Two things that we are uniquely called to in order to be effective communicators of the integral vision: one, to do really high quality work in the mainstream and in integral, and second, to become Gnostic intermediaries. Adult development is possible. There's this implicit assumption in our culture that development pretty much stops around the time the body stops developing. And that is a real tragedy. And the idea that psychological development and spiritual development, of course, can continue beyond the conventional level to post-conventional and even trans-conventional levels has enormous implications. And two of them are particularly important. One of them is what we call normality is not the ceiling of developmental possibilities. That we can mature beyond what we thought was possible. And it's quite possible that the recognition that we can mature further is going to be absolutely essential to our survival and sanity as a species. But there's a further one, and that is that many of our contemporary cultural conflicts are expressions of different levels of development. The conflict over many social and moral issues, such as abortion or religious freedom, can be seen as conflicts between people at different levels of development. And particularly at the current time, our cultures are being torn by conflict between three major developmental levels, between a pre-conventional level or a mythic level, between conventional rational people, and people moving into post-conventional stages. But the trouble is, when the different levels aren't recognized, there's virtually no possibility of resolution and peace between people, because they simply assume that people who disagree with them are either wrong or disturbed or deranged. Contemplative disciplines, spiritual disciplines, can catalyze, can foster this psychological maturation. Of course, not only psychological maturation, but spiritual maturation as well. There are two very, very different kinds of religion, and those are conventional and transconventional. Now, the tragedy is that our culture really is only aware of conventional religion. The defining feature of conventional level religion is that its prime focus is a story or a narrative which is to be believed. And if you believe it, you're saved, and if you don't, you're damned. What is so crucial for us to recognize, and everyone in the integral community does recognize, but the mainstream culture does not, is that there's a further absolutely crucial form or level of religion, and that is a post-conventional level, or better, I think, called trans-conventional level, which centers not on a story, not on a narrative, not on something to be believed, but on a psychotechnology, a set of practices to transform the mind and to cultivate the very qualities and states of consciousness, kinds of insights and realizations that the great religious founders and saints and sages throughout the ages discovered themselves. The most consistent thing they said to cultivate each and every one of these seven qualities was, if you want to develop these qualities, be with people who have them. And that's one reason why an integral gathering like this is so valuable and so beneficial to us all. What's really crucial to recognize is that for the first time in human history, each and every one of the major problems we face, each and every one of our collective crises, is human caused. We are in a race between consciousness and catastrophe. And that we need to address not just the state of the world, but the state of our minds. In short, we need an integral approach. There are two kinds of questions. There are knowledge questions and there are wisdom questions. Knowledge questions have a one-time answer. Is it raining? Look outside? No. End of question. But wisdom questions are like koans. They're questions that each time we ask them, they have the potential for taking us deeper into the question, deeper into ourselves, and deeper into reality. So the question, what's the most strategic thing I can do? Our world is in very, very deep trouble. But our world is also in good hands, because ultimately it rests in yours.
Budapest with these tremendous, integral brothers and sisters has been a tremendous journey thus far. And if we're doing it next year, you should be here.
Recognizing our capacity to catalyze one another and to enter into a higher intersubjectivity and to come into our responsibility to be evolution in action here and now is utterly inspiring. I'm meeting so many bright and amazing people who are themselves in the process of coming alive in new ways in themselves and in relation to each other. We're having a blast.
I've joined this conference to network with other integral people here. I mean, we have just been doing very well in Denmark, and now we want to network with other guys to get into this kind of more global feeling and sharing and mutual inspiration. And I think that is that's really happening here, meeting lots of beautiful people and being inspired and having a chance to inspire others. This is just a fantastic conference.
I came here with a huge desire to be contaminated and contaminate and have great brainstorming with other open-minded people, which I found.
I've been teaching Integral to companies like Apple Computers and Hewlett Packard and Siemens and BMW over the years. So I don't know, I've been Integral most of my life, and I just had to be here because it looks like it's going to be a great party.
So one key, how to create community. Be yourself, be a charismatic leader. How you become a charismatic leader? You have to crack open your ego, go beyond the ego, and find your source, heart center, energy center. You have to find your indigenous soul. I want to put my students through this training. So we teach them the integral theory for 3 years. We put them through experiential therapy groups, okay, what we do here in the afternoons. And we request them to do a meditation retreat at least for 10 days during the 3 years. And we also teach them how to be therapist of others. We call it integral counselor training. And the whole community, the 3 year, together a group for 3 years, is the family and the holding group for all that. So this is kind of the master key that we use, and we used this master key for this conference as well. So you have that spirit, you have the shamanic indigenous, and on the top of everything, in the most outer part of yourself, you have your mental. So please push yourself through this process and be an integral leader. Thank you. Thank you.
We've been presenting and leading workshops in the practice of circling, which is a 21st century integral technology.
People are really dedicated to practice and deepening, especially with intimacy. And we think that if this joins hands with integral, it's going to be very special.
And I've done two presentations, one about adult development and its implications to integral theory, and one about energy and the absence of energy perspectives in integral theory.
The question is, will consciousness rise, or will catastrophe engulf us before that happens? Is it consciousness versus catastrophe? And that's really the question for the human species today. Is this the sunset of our days as a species, as our civilization, or are we going to rise to the challenge?
My speech is on human nature. In particular, I pose the question to all of us, can wisdom only emanate from people with advanced levels of consciousness? To help us shift into just being receptive on non-intellectual channels, my old questions about the value of human life have come to the fore. Is it a separate self-sense and the capacity for reflection always necessary in order to share one's unique gifts and personality? And what you already experienced, my bigger questions remains, what is it that makes us human beings? I really want us to reflect on that question, where the later stage development knowledge of complex theories like Aqual and spiritual insights are always necessary to lead a meaningful life, both fulfilling to the individual and a guiding light to others of how to simply be all one can be. If you look around the globe, you see that each speech community has its own ideas about the characteristics of the ideal human. Young ones everywhere are taught that their tribe or nation holds the only possible or at least the highest truth. As Howard Rheingold once put it, although it's rarely visible to us, we carry around in our heads a conceptual map of the world, a guidebook to rightness and wrongness, beauty and ugliness, value and worthlessness. As integralists, we privilege cognitive complexity and multiple perspective over simpler views. We advocate tolerance as a fundamental integral value. In theory, embracing other ways of being than our own seems obvious and necessary for the good of all. Yet in practice, it remains a challenge to be open to that which tests our own convictions and our own sense of specialness and superior understanding of what matters. Integral theory offers an especially elegant and comprehensive explanation, as well as a set of guidelines for living and a higher purpose for our existence. Because integral theory emanates from US soil, with its as yet young psyche, as Ken also pointed out, many of the integral movers and shakers have an abiding belief in manifest destiny, that is, in the limited potential for growth and expansion. We are disseminating this idea of infinite potential for growth across the globe. We are dedicated to developing superior pedagogies to create a better future for all. Some projects in the third world have already proven that benefits of a more integral design in their interventions. Integral folks also want to generate ever more beauty, more truth, and more goodness. Many integral evolutionaries, especially those who feel spiritually motivated, advocate their beliefs with charismatic idealism. They also often do so without questioning their certainty of knowing the right path for humanity to take. Undoubtedly, Keynes theory and the integral movement are championing the constructive developmental perspective. More evolved humans are held to be more capable of alleviating human suffering and ensuring the survival of our species. As a group, we do see it as our responsibility to become ever more aware and act upon this awareness in tangible ways. We want to actualize our own potential and share our insights about evolution of human consciousness. With your gesture, you are blessing everything that is around you, the people with their triumphs and failures, their joys and sorrows, their beginnings and endings. You bless the earth, the water, and the sky. You bless the good and the bad, the true and the false, the beautiful and the ugly, alike without judgment. Thereby you sanctify all existence with your solid, unwavering presence, your equanimity, benevolence, and compassion. Thank you.
To talk to Europe, who would I call?
I am an idea.
I am a lot of people who share a common history.
I became very rich, using also resources from other continents.
Things that were done in the name of Europe disgust me at one level.
Okay.
And yet, I'm deeply proud to be a European.
The next exercise. Large groups like Hungary, please form smaller subgroups of 5 or 6. Germans also. So groups of 5s. And you're going to conversate with your country members. This is the country process. So, all the groups together, Germans, you know, hang together and start to walk around. You know, you can hold hands, hold elbows. Each nation hang together.
Thank you.
across the integral theory in a couple of workshops that I did 10 years ago. Was quite impressed with the Aqual model and was trying to apply the model, the theory, in my work with clients at McKinsey & Company. So especially in change situations, the integral model proved to be extremely helpful, covering all the quadrants.
This event is fantastic because we have a real meeting of the tribes to create a new tribe, which is the integral world.
I'm talking about integral medicine and how it seems to me that the future of the evolution of integral medicine is something that happens in the lower right. We have many effective treatments. What we now need is the evidence for those treatments so people can get more access to funding. And it's been a really beautiful experience being here at the conference, sharing ideas, hearing different perspectives. It's been the organizers done a wonderful job, and it's been great.
I've been involved with integral theory in a number of ways for quite a few years. My work at the moment is largely in human development and in education. We're focusing quite a bit in higher education and transformative higher education, and now more and more in applications in organizational development and in preparing people for transformative change initiatives. I work a lot with the Experience Integral Foundation in the Netherlands and with a number of other organizations, including Lectico.
This approach, which gives you possibility to take care of people on personal, personal and transpersonal level. I was impressed with this conference, with variety of people who present their views, and I think that we, with our holoscendence approach, contributed with adding the space, practical means of adding the space which can hold all these interesting ideas and means. So I was very happy to be here and participate in many trainings, lectures, groups. So it was a really nicely organized Congress.
To you on behalf of all sentient beings and non-sentient beings everywhere on planet Earth, here now. And they have asked me to pass on to you a message and a question. The question is, how can we co-create a set of thriving pathways for the future of humanity that is irresistible? Irresistible. You don't want to have to use the word integral for a start. That's definitely not a winner, you know, out there, okay? 20 years of my life, I can tell you that. Don't mention it. You may say, what do you do? I'm an integral practitioner. Yes, that's good. But then you don't have to mention it again, okay? Because then you'll demonstrate that you're an integral practitioner, not that you can just talk about it. Why integral? We spent 3 days talking about what is integral, how is integral, experiencing integral. Maybe we haven't done enough thinking about why integral, beyond maybe just sorting my life out and feeling better about things and making a living and, you know, being part of an incredible global community that is changing the world in its own way. Okay, so let's talk about that. Because integral is a part of the solution, there's no question about it. Does anybody disagree with me? We're in a world which is unsustainable, one. High stress, two. Linear economy, i.e. we dig holes on one side of the planet, we extract resources, we pump them through supply chains, and then we go to the other side of the planet, and we, in 2 years, people, 2 years, we deposit 98% of those precious resources in another hole. Another hole, another set of holes. It's insane. The linear economy is technically insane. It's actually crazy, and it's going to destroy us if we don't change it. So let's talk about how we do that. It's powered by renewable energy, conscious evolution. That's really what I've been working towards my whole life. Because today we have an entire planet managed according to a set of measurements which include value-added, stock prices, GDP, dozens of others. They're all dysfunctional. We're measuring the wrong things, and we know it. The Global Reporting Initiative has 6,000 members and 11,000 companies reporting on sustainability. With the UN Global Compact, one of my partners in the Thrivability Consortium was head of the GRI, and the World Business Council for Sustainable Development are struggling themselves to meet their commitments, the world's top 250 companies. It goes on and on and on, because they're not taking this into account. They're still thinking in the old way, how can we be sustainable? They're thinking, what's wrong with our thinking? There's an equation which we measure in the Thrivability Index. It's called the unit of thrival divided by your footprint. So instead of trying to just limit impact, which motivates no one, we want to measure thrival, which motivates everybody. We all want to thrive, right? That's what we want. We want a thriving human civilization on a thriving planet that is beneficial to all life. Does anybody here not want that? What is thrival? Well, Martin Seligman measured it with several million questionnaires and 30, 40 years of research. And his mentor won the Nobel Prize, Daniel Kahneman. So this is based on facts. I'm not talking here from, you know, La La Land. Facts are, number one, positive psychology. People who thrive are people who don't ignore the bad stuff. They face it full on, and they deal with it, and they overcome it, and they move on. How do we cultivate loving, caring, long-term, sustainable, deep relationships that matter? Not shallow la-la-la-la bullshit stuff. Deep, lasting relationships that matter. Not easy. Meaning. What does your life mean? Does it mean anything? Only you can answer that. You have to go inside. But you can't just go inside, because we're not just an inside, we're an outside, right? So we got to go in and out, and all the time. It's a cycle. So we cultivate meaning by doing and by reflection. And finally, we love achievement, we love accomplishment, we love recognition. So, but it's not enough in business. And the problem is today we're just measuring one dimension of five, accomplishment. How much money did you make? How much did you reduce your impact by in sustainability? How much did you do that? That's it. We're ignoring 90% of the resource we have on this planet called us, people. The psychoactive ingredients in Integral are the ultimate breakthrough ingredients. When we want to make breakthroughs in creativity and innovation, which is one of my specialities, disruptive innovation particularly, and you can learn a lot from an alchemist, and I have myself personally had many amazing mentors in my life. But there aren't enough alchemists to transform the planet in time. We have a measurement system. It's based on a template. And that template means that we can take the entire four quadrants and we can build it into the wiring diagrams of the businesses on this planet. Nothing less will do. Every decision that is taken in every business, every day, by every decision maker, has to be wired in to thrivability. That's our goal. So let me leave you with this question. What will it take to make thrivable choices irresistible to leaders at every level of human development everywhere? Thank you.
I'm here today for a very special task to do. I don't know how much religious background you all have, but how would you translate the word prayer to modern terms? What do you mean by prayer? Praying to God. What does it mean today? There is a famous book in Hungarian which has a title which says Conversation to God. Well, that's the prayer. Conversation. But how do you know the response? Most of the prayers are about requests or wishes, right? And you want to have something from God as gift or response. How do you know that he will be listened to? So I'm going to show you a response for this how questions. So the way we are going to work is that I ask Robin to teach us his very famous prayers, 10 sentences of the prayers for the integral people. Prayer is a concentration of the basic, most important messages. I will ask you all to respond to the sentences of the prayer with your mobile phones, modern equipment, and we try to send a message to God through the mobile and have the answers projected to the screen. If we are going to be successful, you will see something on the screen, and I will explain for you what is it there. Resonation. How we resonate to the sentence. We did it individually, but we did it all at once as a group. But in the group process, we are not aware totally, but you, in a way, sense it. Whether your resonation in your heart while you were doing this sliding were similar to the rest of the people here in this room or not. You will see it on the screen. How much the average of the group resonation might be similar to yours or different.
The point here, and this is revolutionary, the point here, if we can organize companies or societies in this order, then we have the
upon the hierarchy.
Upon the natural hierarchy, right, which we can deduct from such simple testing, then we have a transpersonal, integral, hierarchical company, society, group, nation, earth. We cannot create natural hierarchy through degrees, PhDs, you know, positions that you fought or bought for yourself.
If you do it with hierarchy instead of hierarchy,
yeah,
it's forcing people.
Forced, oppressive, you know, hierarchy. That's what we have at hand. So now, with this software, with this thinking, with this knowledge, we start to learn a new way that Integral explains and that Lhotse has how to do it, to see, to make visible the invisible truth in a group, the natural hierarchic order. You need to make a decision as a leader, as a spiritual leader, as a political leader. Are you mature and brave enough to give up your ego and surrender to the field and trust the field and ask the field and put your intelligence and organizational capacities to serve what is seen in this chart projected? Or you are not yet there, you stick to your control, your position, your survival, and you want to be the king no matter what the field and people want. Do you understand this? If you want an integral society, we need to make this shift, and we need to be brave to drop ego in the sense that personal control, no matter what. So that's the importance or the message behind this.
Thank you. Whoa. Take it into your heart, and this sentence will be referred to in a short form with all beings. Remember this word, all beings.
Beings.
Okay? Take the left side of the screen and push the slider until it expresses your feelings at the moment.
Yeah.
And then take the right side and push it up until it expresses the importance of this sentence in the integral society.
Grant me in this moment, O universe, the courage to face and overcome my own challenges so that the suffering of myself and others is transformed into the profound and lasting transformation our world desires with such fervent longing. May the peace, love, and wisdom that surpasses all understanding be with us always, even in the shadow of the valley of death and in our darkest. Bad news to the Requiem people, we're going to survive and we're going to make it. We're going to thrive.
Okay.
Yes.
For the first time, we have an overview of what's going on in Europe, and it's really seems like a breakthrough moment for us. It certainly feels in my life, so it's been one of the peak moments. And I've talked to several people. One approached me and said, look, I've been to like 200 conferences now, and this one is of the best, and I just want to thank my genius partner Ben Seganti with for bringing his style into the conference, which really transformed what a conference can be, right? It's not only an academic endeavor, although we do have great academic content. It's really touching the heart, the soul, the mind, the spirit, and in an integral embrace. So that's what IC is all about, and that's why I'm very happy to be here. And thank you.
There are a lot of exciting people, deep and knowledgeable people doing Integral. And now here we are on the third day of the conference, 500 people from, I think, 30 countries or so. So I can say our vision has been come true. And we created a new format. We want to be true to the term Integral, meaning that we are combining mental sharing and lectures, both academic and general. We're combining that with deep community work and with deep transformational inner work. Integral explicitly says that all levels should be welcome. If we see Integral gatherings, often it's not the case. Integralists tend to refuse everything below turquoise or yellow. Green, not good. Orange, blue, are you kidding? Red, I'm not. Purple, blind faith. Beige, we are over it. It's not true. Our point is, our understanding of Integral, and this is the message with the whole conference format, that we need a healthy green. We want to avoid real authentic sharing. Do we want to avoid being moved? Do we want to avoid heart opening? No, we want that. We want heart opening, authentic sharing, and we want spaces where people can be unconditionally themselves. True Integral truly integrates authenticity, opening, communal events, and of course, can have to integrate orange. There should be a good business model, but orange shouldn't overcome community. And good blue, we need a stable structure, and red, guarding of those energies that want to destroy what we do. And we also need purple. Purple is the stronghold of bonding, of belonging, of faith.
Integral is so important, not only for me, but I think it's a huge gift that we have to give to the world, because the stakes are very high, the challenges ahead are really incredible, so we have to find very clever solutions for the challenges ahead.
And now it was really thrilling to bring together so many people from all different European countries that I didn't know about before, and they came and they co-created, it's a new fashionable word, and there's very high energy here, and I'm very, very happy how new forms of sharing knowledge and bringing up new knowledge that wasn't there before, it's really happened, and it's absolutely exceeded my expectations, and there's so much love that developed between us. Damn happy.
Integral, as I understand, is loving all levels. Not hating the levels, it's loving all levels. So let's not use Integral to cripple all soul. Let's not use Integral to lock our soul into boxes. Let's use Integral to love all the levels and to create an internal integration of levels and an external integration of cultures that we call unity, colorful unity. This is the principle. Each of you with each level, colorful, and we can be united with all the depth, with all the levels and all the cultural differences. And this is, for me, this is the answer for a global Integral. Thank you very much.
I would like to invite everybody on stage who has organized. Please come up, organizers, volunteers, the team, the Hungarian team, the national team.